talk about hockey. You have no idea how badly I want to talk about hockey. Kovalchuk from the blue line blast. He shoots, he scores. No, that would be, I'd be off the post.
Donnie, the most unkind.
Johnny Most doing the Boston Bruins at one time. I can't believe he hit the blanking post. I can't believe it. It was a blue line blast, and he hit the blanking post. I wanted so badly to talk hockey, and
well, it's too bad we couldn't say Alexei Ponikovsky more
I wanted,
today.
And Druda, as good a week as you've had.
I'm really letting this
and
music go a long time.
An incredible. That's enough with a Hartford Whaler theme song.
It's Brass Bonanza.
And by the way, I went to Howie Stump the Schwab, John Saunders, and myself back in 1987 at the beautiful Hartford Civic Center watching the Whale and listening to that crap.
That's a great story.
Now this, Tim, is that would be offsides, and this would be icing. And because, as you know, when it comes to hockey, Rogers, there's only one guy born south of the Mason-Dixon line that's ever called it.
Yeah.
Granted, it was in the Olympic Festival, National Sports Festival, but there were big-time guys that played it. Craig Wallonen, I can go on and on. Mike Richter played in that Olympic Festival.
Yeah.
I was down in I was in North Carolina one year. I was in Baton Rouge another year. In Minneapolis, St. Paul, another year.
That's
a
good place.
And I got to call it. There is nothing more fun. Here's what I did, though, Gavin. Because I knew I could handle line changes, that was not an issue. The problem was when the whistle blew, I didn't know anything.
Well, here's
I didn't know icing from offsides to. So I needed a spotter. I needed a spotter to just point to what the infraction was, and I'd be good to go.
This is what did it for me. 0-2 Olympics.
Okay. All right.
0-2 Olympics, I went to a women's U.S. hockey game.
Right.
And they're just as skilled as the men, but it's a slower pace.
It's a slower pace. Well, you can keep up with the puck.
So you can figure out what they're doing.
Yeah.
And then
that helps.
And then that helps when you're looking at the scrum in the NHL and you know kind of what they're trying to do.
Is Doc ready? You came out of this alive. There was part of
it. I'm a winner. I don't lose. I'm a winner.
Mike Doc Emrick, Emmy Award-winning play-by-play voice, who's got the Caps, the Rangers, tomorrow 12:30 on NBC and the Caps.
Yeah, we're gonna try it again.
How you doing, Mike? It's great to have you.
I'm doing fine. Yeah, I'm doing fine. My only concern is about the athletes because they had to keep going and keep going and keep going, and they seem to be all right. The good thing is they had 2 days instead of just one.
Yeah, my gosh.
I have done a four overtime game twice before. The fours were Islanders, Washington, in 87, and they had only one day off before they had to go into the next series against Philly.
Hey, Doc.
And Buffalo.
Doc, that one in 87, I was waiting to do, I kid you not, I was waiting to do a 230 Sports Center. All right.
Oh, you were?
Yeah. I was waiting to do a 230 Sports Center in Bristol, and Gail Gardner and Berman had never gotten on the air for the 11 o'clock Sports Center until that damn game ended, which was almost 2 o'clock. It was almost 2 o'clock Eastern time. So I got off just, and I tell you what, I was able to watch that entire overtime. And then they told me, hey, we don't need you to do the show. Berman and Gail are going to go ahead and do it. That was incredible for me. I love them.
I didn't realize that you were on duty then.
Yeah.
It was the night before Easter.
Yeah.
You should have had the holiday weekend off.
Well, you know, I was low on the totem pole back then. You know, I was
I
on the food
on
chain in Bristol. I was way down. When basketball, college football and college basketball ended, it was Brando, you do the overnights. Remember, they love you on the West Coast.
Right. Well, you know, the thing about that is the Islanders got on their bus in Washington and went straight to Philly and had the next day to do nothing. And then they had to face the Flyers in game one of the next round the next night. But at least these guys had 2 days off, so we'll see what all of these well-conditioned athletes are made of, because that's for some of these guys, it was over 50 minutes of ice time, and that's an awful lot to do in the span of one night when you're used to playing 25 to 30.
What is this the most, though, cumulative? This is. It's record-breaking, isn't it, in terms of overtimes we've seen this early in any playoff season? It's off the charts.
Well, yeah, there were some in April in Capitals history that were actually in April. They had, as a matter of fact, that one that we talked about was in the middle of April, as I recall. It was the first round in between the Islanders and Washington. But regardless of how far along you are, it does take a toll on you. I remember Peter McNabb was my broadcast partner in New Jersey. He played for the Bruins, and they had one of those multiple overtime games one spring, and he said there were still guys with some after effects of it in the next fall in training camp. Mm-hmm. Just because you're extending yourself beyond what you're accustomed to, and sometimes your decisions made out of fatigue are not good ones, and you get in a lane when you get hit, or you go to a corner and you get pounded pretty good, and it just takes a while. But I don't object to the way of doing it. I think this is far better than doing shootouts or something to determine Stanley Cup playoff games. I think this is part of the tradition, and these athletes are certainly up to it. They're better conditioned than any group we ever had before.
How surprising is this run the LA Kings are making in the hockey world?
It's quite surprising, but they had to struggle to get there, but they did get the number 8 seed. And I remember talking to Scotty Bowman at one time, and he said, beware the number 8, because he had been in the number 1 slot for a number of years and with Detroit. And the number 8 usually has something pretty well built that you have to manufacture in the number 1 spot, because you've been good all year, probably, to earn that position. And these guys have just put it together lately. But there's carryover, even though they're 3 days off at the end of the year between regular season and playoffs. With the number 8 seed, there's carryover, and the Kings certainly have shown it. They've got tremendous goaltending. But as it goes further, we're going to see an awful lot more of a Kings team just than their goaltender. I think that they've gotten tremendous performances out of Mike Richards, for example, and that was what they had hoped for when they made the kind of deal that they did with Philadelphia.
Right. We're visiting with Doc Emrick, who knows more about hockey than any man I've ever known in my lifetime, and, of course, an award-winning, Emmy Award-winning play-by-play voice for NBC's coverage of the Stanley Cup playoffs. Doc, given the fact that there are no teams from Canada that are left, how important is it for some of these storied franchises, like the Rangers, for example, to make runs and to hang around this year?
I think that Canadian fans, of course, are very much... I think it's comparable to baseball fans in the United States in that, okay, if Philadelphia and the Dodgers aren't in this year, they're still going to watch the World Series because it's a part of American tradition.
Yep.
And I think even though, you know, the Canadian teams are out, original six teams are still in, as you mentioned, with the Rangers, but I still don't think that will affect them that much. It's a part of what their tradition is, that they watch the Stanley Cup final. And here in the States, we have a lot of people that will watch it regardless, because it's hockey and it's the last bit of hockey that's left until the long summer ahead.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think there's probably something comparable there. Some of the World Series have not been magnificent matchups, but they've been engrossing games. And so for that reason, people like myself that don't get to watch a lot of regular season baseball early will watch the World Series, and it's the same way in Canada with the Stanley Cup.
Going back to the Philadelphia and New Jersey game, the triple overtimer, talk to me a little bit about the importance of Kovalchuk and the fact that he's back and what that means.
Well, I think the important thing is that he came back and the team didn't change anything.
Mm-hmm.
They went at the Flyers with the same kind of forecheck and the same game plan, as you'd expect. It's just that in the past, and I was just thinking about this earlier today, in 2000, the Devils played the Flyers, and Eric Lindros was out of the lineup early in the series. And then when he came back for the sixth game in New Jersey, it was kind of like the Flyers sort of stood back and let him be the leader that he was, and they watched him do it. Well, he scored a goal, but that wasn't what his team needed to win, so they had to go to a seventh game back in New Jersey, or in Philadelphia, and that was the Scott Stevens hit on him, and the Devils wound up winning the game and winning the series from 3-1 down. The point I'm making is that sometimes when a superstar comes back, it affects the other players in that they decide, okay, he's back now, we can relax or we can do things differently. And last night the Devils did nothing differently, and Kovalchuk was his usual dominant self in the game. When he was out there, you noticed him.
Yeah,
and it was a different feel, but it didn't affect the team play at all.
We'll be watching tonight, of course, on the NBC Sports Network. The cable entity will have Phoenix and Nashville, and, of course, you got the Rangers and the Caps coming up tomorrow. Doc, this was great. It's always special whenever we have a chance to chat with you. Continued success. We love it, and the high-definition hockey is off the charts. We really appreciate your time today.
Thanks, Tim, and now I have a new story for the 1987 Eastern Sea game that you were waiting and waiting, and already Berman had gone home.
Yeah, well, actually, they said, no way are we going to let you come on and do this. I want to talk about it after it's over. So he said, but I tell you what, I learned more about hockey that night in one single night than I think I ever had before. Thank you, Mike. Thank you all. Thank you, Goldberg. We'll see you on Monday.
Okay.